everybody. How's everybody this morning? I want you guys to stand up or sing. We're going to sing Love So Great.
Us. Not to us. Like you need some church today. Before we move on to our next song, I just kind of want to share a scripture with you. We just sang about the wonderful and the mighty love of God. It's so great. And I love the fact that it is a love that is without end. And for those of you who like old country music, I'm not going to break out into some Randy Travis. I got something on that one. But I want to share some scripture with you real quick that you can find in 1 John. This will be around chapter 4. And it says, around verse 9, it says, by this the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world so that we might live through him. And if you jump on down, I love the fact that around verse 18, it says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. And we know that in the love of Jesus, it is a perfect love, because we can go to him and we don't have to be afraid. He takes that fear and knocks it out. And I love that in the Old Testament, it even says that he rejoices over us with singing, because he loves us and he just wants to sing that love song to us. So we're going to do a song. It's been a little while since we've done it, but I believe it's going to speak to us this morning. And it just says, I'm no longer a slave to fear because I have that love of Jesus Christ in my life.
You unravel me with a melody.
I'm no longer Declare out. It's who I am. Do I pray? Celebration Church. Aren't you glad that He's a good, good Father? Aren't you glad that He's perfect in all His ways, because we can't be perfect? I don't hear anybody. Aren't you glad? Come on, give Jesus a hand clap of praise this morning. Listen, my name is Matt. I'm the associate pastor here at Celebration Church, and I just want to welcome you this morning. You're a guest with us this morning and you're wondering what Celebration Church is all about, I'll make it real simple for you. We're all about Jesus. Can I get an amen on that? So listen, if you're new this morning, we've got a worship guide for you. And if you didn't get one this morning, just raise your hand and we'll gladly get you one of those. And in there, it just kind of tells you what we're doing at Celebration Church this next week and into the month. The main thing I want you to know about is next Wednesday, we're having our first Wednesday service. And if you don't know what that is, it's just a time of worship, just like we're worshiping now and giving God all the glory and praise. It's a time for us to just dive into His Word, and it's also a time just to get into prayer for each other, our city, our state, our nation, and this world. And I'm telling you, you don't want to miss out on First Wednesdays. It's just an awesome time in the Lord, an awesome time to just come and just praise Him in the middle of the week, in the middle of hump day, and just forget about all the stress and strain that the world's been bringing against you, and just enter into His presence. And so I would love to see all of you there this Wednesday, and it's in your worship guide starting at 6:30. We just go for an hour, 6:30 to 7:30. The only other thing I want to share is this. If you're new here this morning, we just have this card here, and this is just a way for us to get to know who you are and if we can pray for you. I promise you we're not going to call you and stalk you or show up at your door at 7 a.m. Saturday morning when you're trying to eat your Fruity Pebbles and drink your coffee. It's just a way for us to pray for you and let you know that we're thankful that you chose to come and worship here at Celebration Church. So I just want to enter into a time of prayer before Pastor Rob comes and brings the word this morning. So would you just join me this morning in just closing your eyes and bowing your head? Let's just continue to worship Him through prayer. Father God, I'm so thankful that You are a good, good Father. I'm so thankful that You are perfect because we are not. I'm so thankful, Jesus, that You did on the cross what we could never do. And I'm thankful that You tore the veil between us and You so that we can be redeemed with You and the Father and the Holy Spirit. And Lord, You just reminded me that when You separated the Red Sea, when You brought Your people out of slavery, You didn't just split the Red Sea, Father. It didn't just end there. But they went into the wilderness, Lord, and You fed them. You gave them manna from heaven. When they had no food, You gave them manna. When they had no water, you had Moses strike the rock, the mountain, and living water came forth for them to drink. And so, Father, there's so many this morning that are in that desert place. They're in the season of being in the desert. And all they've got to do is just surrender to You. Just reach out, and You will give them the water that is living, that never runs out, that is eternal. You will feed them manna, the bread of life. So, Father, I pray for all those watching online this morning. I pray for those in the audience this morning, Father, that maybe they're struggling right now. Maybe they're in the desert. Maybe they're in a hard place on dry ground. And God, I just pray that You would open their hearts and their minds to You, to the living bread, to the living water, so they would know, Jesus, You are the way, the truth, and the life. And only You can satisfy. So God, I just pray for Rob this morning. I pray that You would just give him the words to speak. I pray that You would just expound on Your word. And most of all, I just pray that we would receive it, that there would be no distractions, Lord. We just bind those in Jesus' name. Just open our hearts and mind this morning to Your love and Your presence and Your holiness. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Please be seated. Please be seated this morning. If you are a guest with us today and they probably checked your kids in the very beginning, this is the time that we transition to our Kids Celebrate Ministries. We have one of our volunteers back here at the back door. If you would like your child ages 5 to 10 to go to Kids Celebrate this morning, we would love to have them back there with us. I promise you they're going to continue to learn about Jesus. Just follow the trail of kids. That's the easiest way to do it. Right? Some of you big kids, don't try to go back there. I know you think you're a kid at heart, but you need to stay in here. All right? Amen. Yeah, we're glad that all of you are here. Welcome this morning. Listen, I want to do this too. I want to pray for all the churches this morning. So will you agree with me as we're getting ready? Thank you, worship team. You guys killed it, man. These guys come every single Saturday morning, and they sacrifice a few hours. They come every Sunday morning. They're here early. Some of them look like they just woke out of bed, rolled out of bed when they come, but that's okay. Jesus loves them. But they put a lot of heart, a lot of sacrifice. Can we just give them a hand? Is that okay if we give the worship team a hand? Yeah. Listen, I want to say this to you before we pray, and I just feel like I need to pray for all the churches, but I want you to come in close on this one. I want you to understand this. This doesn't happen every Sunday morning by accident. It takes a people that are committed to come and to serve every single week for this to happen. You want to know why they do it? Because they're addicted to seeing lives change for the glory of God. Amen? And so I just want to thank you guys for doing that. All the Dream Teamers, all the ones that do the nursery, all those things. They put in countless hours, and they make sure that this thing goes off without a hitch. So we're very thankful for them. So real quickly, my name is Rob, and the lead pastor here, as Matt said, and we're starting a brand new series entitled Lost. And I had somebody that asked me today if the graphic is somewhat like the show Lost. Well, I've never seen the show Lost. Everybody tells me it's an awesome show. Oh, well, I just have to binge watch it down the road sometime, okay? But I couldn't use their graphic, or I'd be like, hey, come to Jesus, and then go to jail the next day for using a copyrighted graphic. So we thought that probably wouldn't be that great of an idea to do that, so I had to make up my own Lost graphic. Thank you, Betsy. You and I both thought that was funny, and I appreciate you for the Holy Spirit moving in you and through you. And so that just lets me know that we need to get the Spirit out to more people today. All right, let's pray real quickly. Father, in the name of Jesus, I declare your love over this city. This is your city, God. So, Father, I pray for boldness to come upon every pastor right now. I pray for the Holy Spirit, Father, to baptize them from head to toe, that the good news would go forth. I pray for every worship team, every ministry, God, that's in the kids' ministry or wherever they're serving. Father, would love invade every house today. The Mexican churches, the black churches, God, the white churches, God, the whatever church, the Presbyterian, Pentecostal, Baptist, whatever, would Jesus just be celebrated today for your glory? Will you say amen with me? Amen. Maybe one day we'll get it to where everybody's worshiping together just like in heaven. That's our goal here, right? Wherever you come from, we believe in whosoever this morning, and we are so glad that you're with us today. One announcement that I just kind of got last minute that I'll make you guys aware of real quickly is they are having a kids celebrated nursery meeting after service, and lunch will be provided. So if you want to learn how to plug into that, just stay after service and they'll give you lunch. Or if you're part of that, get with Corey and Hope, our team leaders back there, and they'll make sure that you get plugged in and make you get fed. How many people like food after church? Amen. Amen. Three people. That's great. Okay. I guess the rest of you are fasting this year, and that's good. I'm trying to be that spiritual myself. All right. So we are in a series called Lost that we're starting today. And here's the whole objective of this series. Okay. How many people know that Tupelo doesn't need another lukewarm church? How many people know the kingdom of God don't need any more consumeristic Christians? Now, here's the thing about that. I know that we're supposed to start it off all bubbly and nice, and maybe you can come back in a couple of weeks and we'll have a little bit more, you know, 10 ways to be a better Christian sermon. But for the next 3 weeks, what we're going to focus on is really what God has called us to. See, when we started Celebration Church, it'll be going on 4 years. Can you believe that God's allowed us to be here 4 years? It'll be 4 years in August. Right? Which is what we said in the beginning. Will you guys put the mission statement up? And by the way, if you got a worship guide, you should have received sermon notes just like this. Should have been in your worship guide. If you did not get a copy of them, please let our Dream Team leaders know. These are the guys that wear the lanyards or the name tags, and they will make sure that you get a copy of these notes. We would love for you to follow along with us today. It's real simple. I'm going to ask those that attend here regularly, will you look around, and if you see one of our guests doesn't have a copy of notes, will you make sure that they get a copy of notes, okay? Because I would love for you to be able to follow along with us today. So when we planted Celebration Church, here's what we said. We said we just didn't want to be another social club, religious social club that just comes together every Sunday and high fives each other for Jesus, right? Because really, you can do that anywhere. What we wanted to do was we wanted to make an internal impact in our city. We wanted to reach people far away from God. So let me read you our mission statement. It's there in your sermon notes. It says, our mission is to love unconditionally, serve sacrificially, and reach whosoever. Let me stop for a minute. Who's whosoever? Point to yourself this morning. You are whosoever. Come on, you can do it. We're not going to sell you nothing. It's okay, all right? Right? Whosoever. I am whosoever. Friend, never become calloused to that. Okay? In order, right, we don't just love, serve, and reach, because how many people know I can do those three things without loving Jesus? Right? I can love, serve, and reach, right? There's plenty of lost people that do that. In order to reach people, somebody say the word far for me, right? Far. Far from God, right? And they're going to go to the next part. With the life-giving. How many people know that in today's society, there's a lot of death being proclaimed over you? You can't even watch the stinking news. I don't even watch it because it is stinking, right?
I don't even watch it because you'll be depressed after about 5 minutes watching it. We want to speak life over our city. We want to speak life over you today, right? Because Jesus said in John 10:10, he said the enemy tears down, kills, and destroys, and he's trying to take you out. He's speaking death over you, and I'm paraphrasing, but Jesus said, I came that you may have life and life more abundantly. I don't want you to raise your hand today, but I can see it in some of your faces that you need life spoken over you today. You're in a dry place today, and I'm going to prophesy and declare over you today life, because that's what Jesus wants for you. Amen? That they might experience a life of purpose and fulfillment. Now, I want to be careful here because this is not a Tony Robbins statement here, even though I love Tony Robbins and I believe in self-help, but we believe at Celebration Church, and we believe it's biblical, that the purpose that you're looking for in everything else is actually found in Jesus. See, we said it this way for 7 weeks in our I Am series. We said the more you discover who Jesus is, the more purpose, identity, value, and worth you begin to discover. Because everything is found in Jesus, right? And fulfillment. See, there's some of us that are looking for fulfillment today. Unfortunately, we think it's found in bae, or what I like to call baby boo bae. There's so many, I like to just put them all together, right? Baby boo bae. You can use that, by the way. It's free, okay? It's not in bae, even though I love my bae of 20 years. I love her to death. And she's a hot bae, and she's awesome, right? Listen, you can say that in church when you're married. See, don't let me get off on another sermon right there. Will, okay? Right? But my fulfillment is not found in her. It's found in Jesus. For some of us, we think it's in our kids. Listen, I love my Bookie Bookies and the rest of my kids too. But here's the thing. My ultimate fulfillment is not found in them. It's found in Jesus. My career is great. I love a career. I believe in success. I believe that God wants to bless you. But my ultimate fulfillment is not found in that. It's in a relationship with Jesus, right? So a purpose and fulfillment that God always intended it for him. See, some of you think God just has the zapper button on you today and he just wants to zap you. But do you know that God has always intended for you to have a personal, intimate relationship with him that you may find your true identity in him? This is why we exist. And I get a little bit of blowback from this sometimes from believers that maybe grew up in church in what I call spoon-fed Christianity, that you've been coming for 30 years somewhere and it's just been all about you. But can I just be very honest with you? The Bible is not all about us. It's all about God. And we do not make Sunday mornings all about you. It's not because we don't love you as a believer, because we try to meet wherever you're at on your spiritual journey. We try to meet you there and we try to drop those nuggets of truth for you. But here is our purpose today. Here's why Celebration Church started 4 years ago, is to reach people far away from God. And over the next 3 weeks, I want you to see that that's really the heartbeat of heaven. The heartbeat of God, right? I'm going to show you how excited that God gets when lost people come to him. So let me back up, because I feel some of you believers give me that rock stinky eye. You know the Rock from the wrestling? He does this kind of thing. Some of you kind of give me that eye and go, what about me? Listen, we're not saying that there's nothing here for you. What we're saying is you will actually find more purpose and fulfillment in your life when you get on the lost train. When you start going after lost people, your problems begin to dissipate. I'm going to show you in Scripture, right? You didn't get an amen on that. See, Jake's out today. I need a Jake right over here. He was my amen guy, and he's out, right? Don't worry. I'll amen myself if I have to. So why? Why do we talk about this? Why? Well, here's the reason why. Because lost people matter to Jesus, and therefore reaching them should be top priority for us. Okay? Lost people matter to Jesus. Now, I want to caution us today real quickly, and we're going to dive into some scripture. I want to caution us today because you can feel it in the air. Here's what happens when believers hear messages like this. We tend to tune it out. Oh, I've heard that before. It's all about lost people reaching. Well, here's the thing. If we really knew it and the news was so good, then why don't we practice it? Let me say that again. Amen, Rob. That was a good one. Woo! Rob, you're spiritual today, buddy. It sounds good. If we really knew it, in the news that we have, it's actually translated in the language of the New Testament. The gospel is actually translated good news. If the news is so good, then why don't we practice it and reach people, Aren't you glad that you serve a God that says, do as I do, not as do as I say? Come on, parents. You ever had that happen to you before? Right? When you tell your kids one thing and you're like, do as I say, but not necessarily do as I do sometimes. Listen, we serve a God that says, do as I have done, do as I continue to do. Right? Do you know that Jesus left divine glory at the right hand of the Father to come all the way down and be bruised, mocked, and beaten, and spit upon? Right? So that we, by having a faith in Him, could be in a right relationship to the Father, could go from lost to found. Amen? So we serve that kind of deity today. So I want to caution you. Don't tune this out over the next 3 weeks. Oh, well, I've heard that before. Well, I don't want you to hear it. I want you to hear it, digest it, and go take action and invade your neighborhoods and your schools and your cities for the glory of God. Because I'm just going to be very blunt with you, and you're going to hear it from me today. If that's not what celebration exists for, then we need to shut this thing down and go somewhere else. Just being real. Amen, Rob. That was good. Yeah. All right. I'm just telling you, it's important to Jesus. And if it's important to Jesus, then it should be important to us. So we want to love, serve, reach to see lost people discover who they really are for the ultimate purpose of glorifying God. See, we're not just loving, serving, and reaching, right? And reaching lost people just to reach lost people. What we're ultimately doing, or what our ultimate the end is to glorify God. We want to see somebody go from lost to found to a disciple who begins to make other disciples for the glory of God. That is the gospel, right? That is the gospel today, friends. And I want you to hear that. And that's why we mainly do here on Sunday mornings the way that we do things. Let me read you Luke 19:10, because I don't want you to take my word for it. It's in your sermon notes, right? We always say around here, we don't drink the Kool-Aid unless Jesus is pouring it, right? So for the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Who's the Son of Man, by the way? If you didn't grow up in church, that's Jesus. Jesus is intentionally seeking people in order to save people. Can I let you in on a little secret? Here's the cool thing about our God, is He allows us to co-labor with Him in the finding. Now listen, I need you to hear this, because some of us Christians and believers, we get our roles mixed up. We think we can actually save people and fix people. You can't. But here's what your job is to do as a believer, is to co-labor with Jesus in finding the people and bringing them to the one who can save them and change them. You understand? Isn't that awesome that an almighty, infinite, righteous, holy God would allow us to be part of this plan of finding people for His glory? The Son of God came, right, to seek and save the lost. Can you guys put up Philippians 2 just real quickly? It's a reference scripture in your notes. It's not all the way in your notes, but I want you to see this real quickly, especially for those that didn't grow up in church. If you didn't grow up around church, I want you to see this real quickly. It says this, who being in the very nature of God, right? This is Jesus, by the way. Paul, this guy in the Bible who had a radical transformation with God, right? His life was turned around. He went from persecuting Christians to go and finding lost people and to bring them back to Jesus. Right? He says this about Jesus, in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to His own advantage. And here's what it goes on to say. Rather, He made Himself nothing. We need a generation of believers who are willing to make themselves nothing so that Jesus could be everything. That's what's going to change this city. Right? It's not the color of carpet that we have. It's not the style of music that we have. It's not even if we got Connie's blueberry donuts or Walmart donuts, right? Now, none of that matters. It's we need a generation to stand up and say, I sacrifice everything for the sake of the gospel, for reaching people, for the glory of God. That's what we need. Yeah, give God a praise. Yeah. Right? That's a little awkward, but thank you. Yeah, it was great. All right? All right? People are like, should I clap at that? I don't know if I want to sacrifice everything. I don't know. Yeah, okay, I'll just go with it, right? But rather made Himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant. How many people know we need servants in the kingdom of God? We don't need any more consumers. We need some people to go all in and begin to serve and contribute for the glory of God, right? Being made in human likeness. And this is what it goes on to say, that and being found in the appearance of a man. See, Jesus was the only God-man to ever live. Right? He was 100% God and 100% man at the same time. You say, well, Rob, how does that happen? I don't know. We'll go eat cheese dip afterwards and talk about it, okay? When we have more time. He humbled himself. How many people know that it takes humility to be in the kingdom of God? It takes community to love, humility to love somebody unconditionally, to serve them sacrificially. It takes humility to go beyond your barriers of race or socioeconomic status to reach people for the glory of God. But yet Jesus did it by humbling himself from divinity all the way to the cross. You see? Becoming obedient to death. Listen, friends, and you come in close on this one. This is the kind of believer that God is looking for. That you're willing to be obedient to the sake that Rob Sevilla dies. That's what Paul writes in Galatians 2:20. Right? For I have been crucified with Christ. It's not in your notes, but it's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Right? Even the death of a cross. Divine glory comes and he suffers on the cross, the most excruciating death that you could ever suffer in order to reach lost people so they can be found. What's the song that if you grew up in church, we sing Amazing Grace, right? How sweet the sound. May the sound of grace never hurt our ears, right? May it always be that sweet sound of grace. Because God loves to reach lost people. So we're going to be in Luke chapter 15 today. This is, Jesus writes in the book of Luke, there's three things that he writes, three parables. And once again, I don't ever take it for granted that everybody knows about the Bible. But the Bible, the Gospel of Luke, it starts this way in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. For 7 weeks we were in John. Right now we're going to backtrack a little bit and go into Luke. But Luke was actually a Gentile physician. Right, and what better person to be more detailed oriented than a doctor, right? He was hired by a guy named Theophilus to go and take eyewitness accounts of the ministry of Jesus. Okay? How many people have heard of the book of Acts? You've heard of the book of Acts? That's the sequel to the book of Luke. It was written by Luke. Okay? So Luke records three parables in Luke chapter 15. One of them is the parable of the lost sheep, which we're going to look at today. Next week, we're going to look at the parable of the lost coin, and then we're going to look at the most famous one. Even if you didn't grow up in church, you've heard this one, the story of the parable of the prodigal son, the wayward son, or the reckless son, right? There's even a real popular song right now that everybody's singing called Reckless Love, okay? Well, you're going to see that over the next 3 weeks, how scandalous and how reckless this thing really is, okay? So let me set the stage for you real quickly as we read and dive into the scripture today. Here's Jesus. And he's hanging out. And can I just be, I got to use my terminology. That way everybody understands, okay? The tax collectors in the Bible were the worst of the worst. They were the worst. You didn't want to be a tax collector. Here's why. Because they were Jewish that worked with the Roman government. The Roman government was the dominant world power at that time. And they ruled over the Jewish nation. And so what they would do is these were Jewish tax collectors that would work with the Roman government to tax their own people. So let me put it to you a little bit more personally so you can understand it. Imagine if your peeps came by collecting taxes. How many people know there's some fighting going on? Right? Because I never heard anybody goes, yeah, I love to pay taxes. Come on, bring them on. Right? But imagine if your own people came, taxed you the money, collected the money, but imagine even worse than that, just like what they did, what they would do is they would tax more than necessary to pad their own pockets. Now, how many people would be mad about that? That like your brother or sister coming by going, pay up, brother. You'd be like, right? You'd go into Jackie Chan, Dwayne The Rock Johnson mode, wouldn't you? Right? But if you knew they were overtaxing you for the sake of padding their own pockets, you remember the story of Zacchaeus? He has a meeting, a divine experience, a divine meeting with Jesus, and he says, I'm going to repay back all those that I've wronged. Right? You did not want to be a tax collector, because not only did you work for the Roman Empire, but you also were abusing your privileges and your authority by overtaxing your people so that way you could live the lifestyle. Right? So Jesus is right here with tax collectors, and he's with sinners. And sinners is a little bit different. The way they define it here is different than the way we would define it here. So let me just give you a little bit about sinners real quickly. In this day and time, it would have been some sketchy, some shady, even some cringy for some of you younger people, some cringy folks, some shady folks, some sketchy folks. But not only that, but it would also be people that were maimed or deformed because they were considered ritually unclean. The social outcast, the awkward, they would have been in this group because the Pharisees, their actual name means to be set apart, they would not associate with those people. See? And what I love about Jesus is Jesus doesn't leave divine glory to come hang out with the elite. He leaves divine glory to go hang out with the tax collectors and sinners. See, there should be no barrier that exists in our church if we serve Jesus for real. Let me say that again, because some of you need to hear that. Yeah, there needs to be like 50 amens on that one. There should be no barrier that exists in the kingdom of God if Jesus is truly Lord of your church. None. Because Jesus sets the example of what he's willing to go through and all the barriers he's willing to crush to reach lost people, okay? So I need to set that up. If you don't know what a parable is, here's the easiest way I can give it to you. And I learned this in VBS. Thank God for VBS. It's simply an earthly story with a heavenly meaning. Thank God for VBS, people. Amen. I still remember that. I was paying attention a long time ago, even though I was all over the place a little bit. Okay? An earthly story with a heavenly meaning. And here's what Jesus says. Okay? And I'm going to be reading out of the CSB version. And it says this, it's in your notes if you have them this morning. It says, all the tax collectors and sinners were approaching to listen to him, and the Pharisees and scribes were complaining. Can I just, I wasn't going to say this, but I'm going to say it. We need some people to stop complaining in the kingdom of God. When your eyes are focused on Jesus, you have no time to stink and complain about something. Okay? Anyhow, let's get back. The man welcomes sinners and eats with them. This joker not only is hanging out with them, but in this custom, when you ate with somebody, it was like a form of acceptance, right? Let me say this to you, and some of you are going to disagree with this, but I believe it goes along with this. Sometimes you have to let people belong before they believe. Let me say that again. Sometimes you have to let people belong before they believe. Here's why. We're telling the world, hey, come and hear about this Jesus. Come and hear about this wonderful love. But if you're going to hang out with us, this, 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 and this. And you know what the world says? Well, I get that kind of love out here. Why would I want to come to your church and talk to your Jesus? Sometimes you have to be willing to cross any barrier, right? Nothing sinful. That's not what I'm saying. To meet people where they're at, because if they truly encounter grace, grace won't leave them the same way. See the difference? Right? So here's Jesus eating with them. He's hanging out with them. He went over to the Denny's, the Waffle House. He's at the IHOP with them, okay? And he said this. He welcomed sinners and eat with them, so he told them this parable. What man among you who has 100 sheep and loses one of them does not leave the 99 in the open field and go after the lost one until he finds it? Now, let's stop for a minute. Can we go back, guys, real quickly? Now, I didn't major in economics and accounting and money and all that kind of stuff. But not many people are going to go after one sheep and leave the 99 in the open field. Right? But Jesus is saying, I'm going to leave the 99 to go after the one. See, Jesus' ways are counterintuitive, they're counter-cultural, right? Because for those that are in college or been through any kind of school, right, this mathematically doesn't make any sense, right? No rational person is going to leave 99 good to go after the one that has strayed away. But look at what Jesus says. Does not leave the 99 in the open field and go after the lost one until he finds it. When he has found it, I love this, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders, and coming home, he calls his friends and neighbors together, saying to them, rejoice with me, because I have found my lost sheep. I tell you, in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than the 99 righteous people who do not need repentance. So this is how my sense of humor works and how my mind works. I want to play you a little bit of song, and I don't know if they have this in heaven or not. But here's kind of how what I think. Jesus and the angels and all of heaven, they celebrate, man, when lost person comes home. Can you guys play that for me real quickly? Can you turn it up? Turn it up. Come on. It's all the angels, all creation. They're like, oh, a lost person's coming. A lost person's coming. Oh, a lost person's coming. And Jesus is like, I got a feeling that today's going to be a good day. Right? You understand? You understand? Come on, keep it playing for a second. Come on.
I got a feeling.
Can you see the angels? They're like,
that tonight's going to be a good night. That
right?
Tonight's going to be a good night.
Come on. See, there's a party going on in heaven when lost people come home. Right? Now, I don't know. This is not necessarily a Christian song, and some of you religious people may get really mad, and that's okay. We love hate email. All right, turn it down, guys. But here's the thing. We should be that excited every Sunday when we come here, because it's another opportunity for a lost person to come home. It's another opportunity for the lost sheep, for the shepherd to go and find them. It's another lost opportunity for the prodigal to come home. Listen, if you've got a son or daughter who's far away from God, friend, you do not give up praying for them. Because there's no place too far that the shepherd can't go find them. Amen? Come on. See, and what I want you to see here, friends, what I want you to see here is that the shepherd is the one doing the initiating and the seeking and going after. Because some of us, we feel so far away today. And we're in shame and we're in condemnation. And the devil's going, oh man, they don't want you there. You got to get your act together before you go to church. You got to do all these lies he's trying to tell you today. And the shepherd is constantly looking for you. And he's coming after you. And for some of you today, you're on a collision course with the cross. Amen? The shepherd will come and get you. And I love it. He joyfully puts him on his shoulders. I don't know how heavy a sheep is, but I would say they can get pretty heavy. Right? Now, if I was having to carry it from here to my car, it'd be a different story. But we don't. But some of us that are far away, the shepherd joyfully picks us up, puts us on his shoulders, and he brings us home. And there's a song in heaven. I don't know if it's the Black Eyed Peas. I don't know. But I wanted to give you that song because we need to have that type of feeling 7 days a week. Right? That I got a feeling someone's going to come to know Jesus today. Right? Amen? Isn't that good? Look what Paul writes in 1 Timothy. 1 Timothy 1:5, it's there in 1:15. It says this, here is a trustworthy saying. Man, underline the word trustworthy, saying that deserves full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of who I am the worst. Don't you feel that way? That if he could save me, he could save anyone. If you don't, then friend, revisit the foot of the cross today. Revisit the foot of the cross today. This is, Paul's saying, you can bank on this, Timothy, that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners, right? To save sinners. He is in the business of saving the lost. Isn't that good? And if he is in the business of saving the lost, then we should be in business with Jesus, right? We should be co-laboring with Christ and laboring with him. So here's the truth that I want you to see. It's your first little line there. It says this, lost people, it's on the bottom of the left-hand side of your sermon notes. Lost people are important to God, right? Therefore, they should be important to his church, right? Important to his church. We may have changed it there. It may have it on there. We may have church underlining your sermon notes. We may have forgotten to change that. So if that, just fill it in. But if lost people are important to God, important to Jesus, then lost people should be important to his church. Why? Well, what are we called? Christians. Right? And if Christ went after lost people, then what do you think we should do? Right? Go after lost people and ourselves. Let me give it to you, Luke 10, 18 through 20. And it says this. Okay? It says this right here. He replied, I saw Satan fell like lightning from heaven. Jesus is sending out 72 people in this particular chapter to go do his work. He says, I have given you authority. Who gives the authority? Jesus, right? To trample on snakes and scorpions, to overcome all the power of the enemy. Please don't get that passage of scripture misinterpreted. I don't have time to get into it today, but we can talk about it later if you don't understand that. Nothing will harm you. However, listen, do not rejoice that spirits submit to you. See, his disciples were like flipping out. They're like, hey, Jesus, man, we went and spoke to some spirits and they submitted to us. And they're like, let's high five each other. And Jesus is like, no, 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 no. Let's keep the main thing the main thing. And the main thing is that you once were lost, but now you're found and your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So listen, I need you to hear this morning. Come in close on this one. Listen, at Celebration Church, we believe in all the gifts of the Spirit. I believe in them all. Why? Because the Bible says they exist. But here's the thing we don't teach. We never chase signs and wonders here at Celebration Church. But we do believe that if we're walking in the ministry of Jesus, that signs and wonders follow true believers. You see? See the difference? Jesus is saying, wait a minute here. I've given you this authority, but you're missing the main thing here. The main thing is that you impact your cities, that you impact your nation, that you impact your neighborhoods, that you impact your schools so that lost people could be found for the glory of God and their names be written in the book of life. I love what the great Charles Spurgeon says, right? The great Baptist preacher, Charles Spurgeon, he's AKA known as the preacher among preachers, okay? And he says this, he says, I would sooner bring one sinner to Jesus Christ than unravel all the mysteries of the divine word, for salvation is the one thing we are to live for. See, friend, you could be a master theologian, and that's great. God wants you to be that. I believe in striving for excellence and preaching the word. I believe you should go to seminary if God opens that door. I believe in all those things. But the reality is you can have all the information, and it just stays here, but it never transforms you and puts your love and your faith into action. And that's what Charles Spurgeon is saying here, that genuine faith is love in action. Right? I could tell you all about eschatology and the end times. I could say big fancy words like justification and sanctification and propitiation. See, that sounds really spiritual, doesn't it? But if no lost people ever come saved through this ministry, then we're missing the whole point. God, let us keep the main thing, the main thing. And that's that Jesus Christ came into the world to save sinners. Right? Like Paul, which I am the worst. Thank you, God, for your grace. Amen. Thank you, God, for your mercy. Thank you, God, that you love us. And so you're saying, well, Rob, okay, I understand now that lost people matter to Jesus, but what can I do? Well, I'm glad you asked. Because I got four things, right? Usually I do three, but today God was so good he gave us four. Isn't that awesome? All right. Thank you for the increase, Lord. Right. Thank you for the increase. Right. You may be wondering, what difference can I make? You don't understand, Rob. I'm not some great Bible theologian. Well, I just gave you a quote that says you didn't have to be. How many people know that your story or your testimony sometimes can make the greatest impact more than you bringing 10 King James Bibles with you? It's not that I'm against the word. I love the word. It's the gospel, right? Paul says in Romans 10 that how can they hear without a preacher? But what I'm saying to you is your testimony God has given you, not for you to brag about and go share at churches and in youth groups and all those things are good, but ultimately he's giving you that testimony so that lost people could be found people. And friend, found people find people. Let me say that again. Found people find people. So what can I do? What difference am I going to make? Does my voice even matter? Well, here's the good news. If you look in the Bible, right? I'm tempted to sing that song, but I'm not going to, right? If you look in the Bible, the good news is God used common, ordinary, jacked up, social outcast people to advance his kingdom. And you want to know the better news? He's still in that business today. He still uses jacked up, cringy, sketchy, shady, messed up people to advance his kingdom. Here's the good news. All of us are candidates. Isn't that good? See, some of you are like, you speak for yourself. No, you are. You just don't see your own self-righteousness. Amen. For the glory of God. All right, let's get us out of that one, God. All right. We're not just saved something. See, all we hear all the time is get saved. And that's great. But what happens is we preach all the time about being saved from something, but sometimes we're anemic in the for something. See, God saved us from hell and death and from ourselves because we were dead in our sins, but now he has saved us to be on mission in his kingdom for his glory. Amen? That's the purpose and fulfillment that some of you are looking for. Listen, I love you, but I got to say it this way. Some of you are dying in lukewarmness and complacency today because you've allowed the things of life to overwhelm you. And Jesus is trying to get your attention today and say, no, I got the solution that if you will come and understand that you are saved for something, watch everything else begin to dissipate for the glory of God. See? I know that's a hard truth, isn't it? That's a hard truth. But remember your first love today. That's what the Lord is saying. Remember your first love. There are lost people in our homeschool groups, in our schools, in our works, right? Wherever we go, our colleges, whatever we do, there are lost people all around us. And Jesus is not saying, I need your help. Jesus is saying, will you make yourself available? Will you make yourself available for the kingdom of God today? So number one, what can I do? Accept the responsibility. All right, we'll go through these real quickly. Accept the responsibility. Should be in your notes. Do you know that it's not my job alone to go after lost people? It's not the special evangelist. It's not the special ministry. All of you are ministers of the gospel if you're born again today. I'm going to show you in Scripture, right? It's all of our responsibility to share the kingdom of God. Can I say something else just this way? I believe a deep commitment to the gospel should result in a deep commitment to the lost. Okay? I'm going to give another hard truth here. It's hard for me to believe that you're genuinely born again and a disciple of Jesus if you're not sharing the good news. Well, Rob, that was a little hard. I'm going to give you half an amen on that one. Go read the gospel. Go read the gospel. I'm not saying it to say it. I'm telling you what the gospel says. Accept the responsibility. Matthew 28, 18 through 12, this is what we call the Great Commission for those that didn't grow up in church. This is not the great suggestion. Unfortunately, it's become the great omission. But this is the Great Commission. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven. See, Jesus has the authority to give the orders. On earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples. How many people know you can just go and never do anything and do a lot of busy work? But he gives us a definite plan. We got to make disciples by how? By going, by baptizing, by teaching. That's what he says here. Right? Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. I hear people all the time and say, man, I just want intimacy with God. I want intimacy with God. Well, God's giving you the formula here. Begin to live on mission with God and for God. See, some of you are starving for intimacy. Some of you are going, man, I feel far away from God. And what I would submit to you today, friend, is, are you on mission with Jesus? Because he promises to be with you to the very end of the age. Accept the responsibility today, right? Go and make disciples. Let me share this real quickly, just in case there may be some believers here that don't understand this whole Christian walk. Here's what happens. I'm lost because of the cross. I'm found, right? And that just is the beginning of the journey. Because now we need some people in the church to raise their hand and go, here am I, Pastor Rob. Here am I. I'm willing to make myself available to help them go from to a mature disciple, right, that now gets back in line and makes other disciples. Let me say it again because I lost somebody. Somebody went, Okay, so let's say it again. You're lost because of the cross. You're found. Someone in the biblical community, a mentor, whatever, says, I'm going to walk this journey out with you, and I'm going to disciple you through this life. And how many people know that could be 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years? It could be a lifetime. Right? But the whole purpose is to get this person that was once was lost, is now is found, is now a disciple of Jesus, into a fully functional disciple who makes other disciples for the glory of God. But God is telling some of us, accept the responsibility. How many people know what excuses are like? I won't say it because some get offended. Right? They're like opinions. Well, you know what those are like, right? Some of you are like, oh my gosh, what kind of church am I going to here? I'll just let you digest that and meditate on it. But how many people we know that we can make excuses all day long to not reach lost people, to not live on mission, right? I'm just being real. Can we be real? It's just, we can make excuses all day long to not accept the responsibility, and the reality is that this is a mission impossible apart from the Holy Spirit being with us and working through us. But here's the good news, that an infinitely righteous, holy, good God says this: I want you to co-labor with me in this mission. I want you to be part of this mission with me, right? But are we going to reorganize our lives in such a way that we reach our cities, our schools, right? Ultimately, the nations. That's what we exist for. Celebration Church exists. You should exist. Let me put it to you this way as a pastor. I hear people all the time, oh, I want Celebration Church to grow. Well, are you doing your part? Are you accepting the responsibility? Because I promise you, people aren't going to be coming through that door, because that's not the gospel way. The gospel way is to be intentional about seeking lost people. See? You want Celebration Church to grow? You want this ministry to grow? Then starts today by accepting the responsibility for the glory of God. I knew I wouldn't get a lot of amens on that one. That's okay. Number two, not only does God want us to accept the responsibility, but he wants us to take action. Well, what do you mean, Rob? I thought you said it was justification by faith. And, I thought you said that Paul says it's not about works. And, yeah. That is true, but here's the thing that you need to understand. We don't work for salvation. We work from our faith. We work from salvation, right? In other words, if you're truly born again today, there should be an action that takes place in your life to wanting to see God glorified, right? And what better way to do that through taking action, right? Going all in is what I like to call it. Being intentional. No spectators. How many people? Listen, man, I just declare over this church that we wouldn't have any spectators in 2018, that we wouldn't have any sideline Christians in 2018, but that we would be all in for the glory of God, right? For the amen, Rob. We need to play that song again. I got a feeling, right, that tonight's going to be a good night. See, real faith is love in action. Invite someone, right? Invite someone to Jesus. It's not about inviting someone to Celebration Church, because Celebration Church can't save or change anyone, but I know the one who does. And our job here is to lead you and point you to the one who can change your life. Remember the big Nike slogan? We've worn the shirts. We wore the tennis shoes. What is their big famous slogan? Just do it. Man, the church needs to adopt that slogan. We just need to do it. No excuses in 2018, right? I pray against the spirit of complacency. I pray against the spirit of lukewarmness, right? I declare that that would be broken over your life if that's you today, right? And that you would have a fresh, right, a fresh revelation, a fresh insight of who he is. Acts 1:8 says, but you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. In other words, Jesus left us with the Holy Spirit, right? He sent us the Holy Spirit so we could have the power to be what? Do you want to know what your main part in the body of Christ is? It's to be a witness. In the language of the New Testament, that means a billboard or an advertisement. I am to be a walking billboard for Jesus so lost people could see the Jesus in me, so they would want to know the Jesus who's in me and working through me. And when he says witnesses in Jerusalem, right? In our city, right? Even in our hometown where people don't accept us. We're supposed to be a witness in Judea, right, in our state, right? In Samaria and to the ends of the earth, in our nation and to the ends of the world, I have given you the Holy Spirit to go and to see lost people come to know me, to be a witness for people could be found that are lost, right? See, here's what I love. The same Jesus who gives the orders is the same Jesus who supplies all the power necessary to carry them out, to fulfill them. So friend, it's not in your own strength. It's not in your own power. You don't have the boldness within you or the courage to do it. But there's one, if you're born again, who's living in you, who will give you the boldness and the courage to share the good news of Jesus Christ. Okay? That's what Jesus is saying here. He had a whole bunch of jacked up men waiting on him. He says, you wait. You listen, I'm giving you all these things to say, but you can't do it in your own power. I'm going to supply you the power necessary to do, excuse me, what you need to do, okay? So let me ask you something. Would you agree that our city is going to be hard to reach when the church stays in the building? Let me say that again. Would you agree with me? Maybe we could just get three, because we got to have two or three. No, I was kidding, right? Maybe three. Would you agree with me that it's hard to reach people if we stay in our cubicles at work, if we stay in our car and we're scared of everybody, if we never get outside the building? Would you agree with me it's going to be hard to reach lost people? Yeah, it is, right? It's impossible. Well, Rob, I'm introverted. I read this thing on Facebook that gives me an out, because it said introverts, this is the top 10 things introverts don't do. Here's my reply to you today. It's not you. It's the Holy Spirit in you. Right? We'll just stop there. Right? So take action. Some of you introverts are like, we're going to have a talk after church, man. I'm going to meet you out in the parking lot, man. Okay? That's okay. Number three is, not only do we want you to accept the responsibility, take action. Here's what I believe is the most important one, is pray. We are so anemic in the arena of prayer in the church. We need someone to pray. We need people to be on their knees interceding for people, right? Praying for lost people, praying, right? So let me ask you this. When's the last time you prayed for your pastor, wherever you go to church at? Because I promise you, all hell is coming against them and their family. Because the enemy doesn't want to see lost people saved. When's the last time you prayed for your other leaders? When's the last time you prayed for your church to grow? Oh, there's one. Do you know that it's God's will to grow this church? But he's waiting for you to make yourself available to go reach the people. Right? Amen. When's the last time you prayed for your church to grow? When's the last time you prayed for the lost in your city? When's the last time you prayed for divine appointments throughout the week? That God, when I go to the gas pump, that I'll have the opportunity to witness to someone. When I'm coaching at school, God, that you would open up a door for me to share with someone. God, when I'm in my homeschool group, that you would open up the door to share with someone. God, when I'm in the cubicle, when I'm talking on the phone, when I'm at Starbucks, that you will open up the door for me to share the gospel with someone. When's the last time? When's the last time, boy, this is one, that you prayed for the Holy Spirit to baptize you and refresh you and refill you so you will have everything necessary to accomplish the mission that he's called you to? See, friends, you don't have to be scared of the Holy Spirit today. You want to know why? Because he's God. And he will give you the power to do this mission. Real quickly, number four, give. Right? Not only accept the responsibility, not only we take action, not only does God want us to pray, but here's one that puts a lot of underwears in the wad. Baby, I'm getting better at that. My wife's helping with that, right? I used to say the other word, but my wife is helping me by the grace of God. I'm growing. Thank you, Jesus. But some people get all uptight, right? I'll just do this to kind of uptight, right? When you talk about giving, because they're, oh, I knew it, man. The church just wants my money. Listen, if that is your heart, then we already have a heart issue already. Because the gospel is full of people who gave everything for the sake of Christ. Sacrificed everything and relinquished everything for the sake of the gospel. Let me read you this scripture real quick. And now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace of God. This is 2 Corinthians 8:1-4. And it says, that God has given the Macedonian churches. There was this guy named Paul who was radically transformed. I got carried away with the yellow there, so bear with me, okay? There's a lot of things I wanted to highlight for you. But here's what I want you to see. Paul is writing to other churches about giving in 2 Corinthians, right? He's writing to them, and he's like, listen, I want to give you an example of a church that knows how to give, right? Listen what he says here. I need you to see this today. In the midst of very severe trial, how many people are going? Don't you raise your hand. Just think about this. How many of us could say this week that I've had some severe trials? I've gone through some stuff, Rob, right? Their overflowing joy. That doesn't even make sense to have overflowing joy in severe trials, because how many people are like me and just want to complain and cry all the time when we go through something? Right? And he says, and in their extreme poverty. They weren't just broke. They were like ghetto broke. They have trials and they're broke. There's a lot of overdraft fees hitting, in other words. Okay? There's too much month and not enough money. Okay? This is what he's saying. This is what he says. Welled up rich generosity. Not even generosity, but lavish, abundant generosity rose up in them. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able and beyond their ability, entirely on their own. I love that, Pastor. Underline that, entirely on their own. It should never take a preacher or some commercial with kids on the TV or, you know, this kind of thing to manipulate you. I don't want to manipulate you for all the wrong reasons, but I want to motivate you today for all the biblical reasons that God needs some people to rise up and give everything for the sake of the lost in this city. That's how serious this is, right? They gave entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing this in the service to the Lord's people. They went and begged Paul. How can we give more so more lost people could be taken care of, so believers back home could be taken care of, so the orphans and widows could be taken care of? When you're in it with Jesus, listen, I'm going to close with this. When you're in it, when you're living on mission for Jesus, what happens is your problems and things begin to dissipate. It doesn't mean that your problems are not important. It doesn't mean what you're going through is not important. But what it means is when you're on mission with Jesus, he's with you, right? And everything else seems to fade away, right? Why? Because the gospel is others focused. David Platt said it this way: every saved person this side of heaven owes the gospel to every lost person this side of hell. Right? Why do we do these things? We do these things because it shows that we've never gotten over being saved. May we be a church that never gets over being saved. That's what I declare over you today, friends. That you never become calloused to seeing lost people come to Jesus. That you never become immune to seeing the broken, the disenfranchised, the hurting, those that are angry and different come to know the Jesus that we know. Let's pray. Father, we love you today. And so, Father, I pray for the non-believer today. If you do not know Jesus today, this is my prayer for you, that right there in your seat, that you would cry out to him. I can't give you the words to say, but the Bible says that if you will call out to the name of the Lord, and if you'll just say, Jesus, I repent, I need saving today, will you save me? The Bible says that if you confess your sins to him, and if you repent to him today, if you cry out to him, if you wave the white flag of surrender, that he is faithful and just to save. If that's you right now in your seat, come on. If that's you, you cry out to him in your spirit, and you tell him, I need saving today. I need saving. I'm laying my yes down to you, Jesus. I'm laying my yes down to you, Jesus. If that's you right now, just take a moment. If that's you, call out to him. No one's going to come to your seat. You just right where you're at, you call out to him.
Come on, if you're a believer today, I want you to start praying for those family members, those friends, those neighbors, those co-workers. But what I pray over you today as you're praying for them is, Father, in the name of Jesus, would you baptize some hearts in here afresh, God? Would you baptize some hearts, God, today in your Holy Spirit? Would you revive them, God? We speak against the spirit of complacency, the spirit of lukewarmness, God, the spirit of the sideline Christianity, God. We pray for all that to be broken. And Father, I pray that you would raise up some people that would be all in for your glory. Come on, believer, if that's you, you tell them, say, I need a refreshing today. I need you to refresh me. I need you to refill me today. See, your invitation could lead to someone else's transformation for the glory of God. Amen. Real quickly, just take a minute to respond. Carlos, I think Peyton's going to lead us in something. Just right where you're at. Come on, just stay focused. Wake up some believers in this place today. Set them afire for your glory, Jesus. Father, save some sinners, God. Heal some brokenhearted in our city, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Can we sing that one more time, guys, as we're still praying? Shepherd's coming to find you today. Come on. He's joyfully coming to find you today. Just a few minutes here before we close shop today. I want you to look up here real quickly. Come close. We do our offering here differently every Sunday. We do it a little bit different than most churches. We have two brown boxes in the cafe area. And this is mainly for those that are called Celebration Church, your faith family home. But also if you're a guest, that connection card that's in the back of every seat, if you're a guest today, would you take that, fill it out, fold it up, drop it in there? It's self-explanatory. You should be able to fill it out. But I want to share this with you. I'm running out of time, so I got to hurry real quickly. I want to share this with you. This was in your worship guide today. Okay? This is an invite card. I've made these up for the last 2 or 3 years. Unfortunately, many people haven't taken advantage of it. And I'm not trying to be mean today, so if I'm coming across as angry preacher guy, that's not my goal. My goal is 2018, God needs a people on fire. I'm not playing church. I don't want to play church. I said that from the beginning. We're not playing church here. We're going to reach our city for the glory of God. Okay? But I made these cards that says, you're invited. Here's what I do almost every week. I have some smaller ones out there. They're right out there in front of Kids Celebrate. They're in your worship guide. I want you to pray about who you would invite. And I want you to take an act of faith. You're not doing it for me. You're not doing it for Celebration Church. You're taking an act of faith for Jesus. And here's what I do at the gas pumps or when I go in the gas stations. Here's what I do. Hey, by the way, this is how I do it sometimes. Hey, by the way, what's your name? What's your name? Holt? Hulk? Holt? Okay, Holt. I say, hey, Holt, man, God just told me to come over here and invite you, man. I don't know if you got a faith family or if you go to church. I don't even know where you're at in your spiritual journey. Every time I say that, guess what they tell me? They tell me where they're at on their spiritual journey. Let me do it again. Give it to me. This is how easy it is. This is evangelism 101. Hey, man, what's up? What's your name? Hey, Holt, I'm Rob. I don't go, I'm Pastor Rob, Apostle Rob, Prophet Rob. I don't do none of that. I just say, I'm Rob. Hey, man, I'm Rob. I go to this church called Celebration Church. Man, they love jacked up people, messed up people. Man, they love all kinds of people, black, white. Man, they even like Mexicans like me, man. Isn't that awesome? Right? I don't know if you have a faith family to go to, but can I just give that to you and invite you, man? I don't even know if you believe in God or where you're at in your spiritual journey. Guess what they always do? They tell me where they're at. Okay? Can I take 2 minutes? Will you give me 2 minutes? said, okay, I'm going to share this story because it's powerful. I know I'm running over, but 2 minutes, okay? We won't make a habit of it. We've done it 2 weeks in a row, but we won't make a habit, I promise. But listen, right? Somebody, man, I really wanted to be cheese dip at 12 o'clock straight up, okay? 2 minutes, I promise you'll change your life. 2 minutes. I said, okay? 2 minutes. Here we go. There's this young lady who's attended here, and God would put me in her path over about a three-year period of time. And every time I would see her, I would invite her. See, your invitation could lead to someone's supernatural transformation. That's how powerful an invitation is. Then one of the top reasons people say they don't come to church is because they say, my friends have never invited me. Matt had a guy that he ran into that said in 8 years, no believer has ever invited him to church. It's a true story. Talk to Matt right here on the front row afterwards. So this lady would come into my life. About every 2 to 3 years, I'd see her at the Mexican restaurant. As you people know how I roll. I like to eat there, right? And all these other places. And I would invite her every time and invite her and invite her. I remember one day, God just told me, man, you need to be more bold about it and invite her. And I was like, if you'll come, man, I promise you, God will change. It has nothing to do with Celebration Church. There's no magic here, right? We turn it all over to Jesus, okay? So anyhow, she finally comes, and her life begins to change. I remember one Wednesday night, she sat right over here somewhere, and she wept, and she wept, and she wept because Jesus was changing her life. But here's the kicker. I need you to take this, to hear this, and then we'll get out of here and close. Through a result of an invitation to her, it allowed her son to come to faith in Christ. I led him to Christ back in the kids' celebrate room down a Saturday morning. Your invitation could lead to someone else's supernatural transformation. So even if that invitation is not for that person, it may be for someone else within their family at that point in time. Never discount the value of an invitation. So pray about it. Take those cards. Take one at least. I hope you take more. We got hundreds of them. But you think about those people you coach with, those people you go to school with, those people you go to work with, and you say, God, would you give me the boldness to invite them? Because you never know, man. That may be the beginning of a new journey for them. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for this time of offering. And Father, I thank you for your reckless love. I thank you for your scandalous grace, God, that you would love us, that you would pursue us, God. That in your initiating love, God, you came after us and you had a plan for us, God. So may we go forth and sow into your kingdom and give everything that we got, Father, for your glory. Would you use this in such a way, this time of offering, for your glory and your glory alone? Would you say amen with me? God bless you guys. Have a great Sunday.